90% of our women had experienced, if not physical violence, sexual violence, or emotional violence of some kind. I just knew that clarity of a place, the safety, that things didn't vacillate or change, or, you know, they were in one day and out the other, that they could have clear expectations of us. I knew that that was critical to helping them get grounded.
The way I was living on the streets, and, you know, it was just such an unhealthy, toxic place to be in. And so I would still be very sick in the way of not growing. I would be miserable. I wouldn't be who I am today. I wouldn't smile today. You know, I wouldn't have confidence today. It's just, I was not in a good place.
The recovery that occurs in our care is really just the beginning. And to establish that relationship with these clients so that they know that we're there, that they can circle back, we can plug them into community support, which is critical, giving women and children an opportunity to live their best lives, whatever that is for them.
I think that CG has an amazing staff, and we do. We work together. We work. If there's issues, we talk to each other. We try to communicate and do the best that we can for what's best for the residents.
The Center for Great Expectations has had a long-standing and deep relationship to our center as a research center. I've spent my career trying to develop treatments for women who have traumatic stress and addiction. But one of the barriers, you know, as a research scientist, is that going from the laboratory into the community is one of the, what they call the implementation cliff, that you have difficulties bringing treatments that are evidence-based, that we know work, into the community. And what I love about Center for Great Expectations is that they're doing that.
Well, I think we recognized over time that trauma was at the core of everything that we do.
There's something romantic about rescuing a lovely little baby, but how do you love and heal and provide well-being for a child whose mother has been injured, whose mother has been harmed? What about that?
Just to watch a woman and her child work at what that relationship looks like in early sobriety, learning how to be a mom again, it's just so much work that they do each and every day.
Helping us understand more the impacts of childhood exposures to trauma and the way that it may lead a person to develop an addiction problem, and how important that is to stop intergenerational transmission of trauma and also of addiction issues in families.
It's hard to like put into words, but I'd say like when I came in, I was afraid, ashamed, confused, didn't know how to be a mom, didn't know if I could be a mom, had no confidence, no hope, nothing. And I was miserable. I was really miserable.
Our specialty is treating pregnant and parenting women. And I think that just looking at the cycle that many of these women have found themselves in generationally, and really drilling down on what they experienced, and then offering an individualized plan to help each individual woman, and then tracking it as we go.
Typically, if a pregnant or parenting person is able to overcome the many barriers to treatment, the mom and baby are seen and treated separately. So mom might go to treatment for the symptoms of substance use, and the baby may or may not receive early intervention or play therapy, but they're treated as two separate entities, and then they come back to a relationship which is still characterized by intergenerational patterns of trauma. And at Center for Great Expectations, we view and we work with the mom and the baby, or the mom and the child as a whole, as an interdependent system that's embedded in a system of community and of culture, that the mom and the baby affect each other, they are affected by their community, and they affect their community. So it's messy, And we don't simplify that, and we don't back off that and try to just treat symptoms. We work with the relationship between mom and baby. Our client is not mom, our client is not baby, our client is the relationship between the two.
I've been working with the Center for Great Expectations since I first arrived at Rutgers in 2015. And one of the first things that we did together is to bring trauma-informed programs to the Center for Great Expectations and augment the really excellent trauma-informed work that the center was already doing.
It's a foundational component in our treatment model, but also to really expand to give all individuals medication-assisted treatment in our outpatient program. The center has been offering MAT for a number of years. It is really the only evidence-based approach to treat opioid use disorder. An abstinence-only mindset that is sometimes shared through the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous and Narcotics Anonymous, it actually does clients a tremendous disservice by suggesting that they're not quote-unquote really sober if they're on medication-assisted treatment, when in fact it is a critical piece in recovery from opioid use disorder. You know, we've been at this a while now, and we feel pretty confident that we have something very special, that we're responsible to share it.
My son, Caden, he's 13 months and like 7 days, and he's just grown so much. So I'm proud. I'm a proud mother. I feel like confident, strong, ready. I have hope. Like, I can't wait.
I think we give people their families back and their confidence back. It's just really special.
We need to be able to expand. And we've always believed that you either deliver solid care that's driven by patient needs and not by the funding that you're allocated. And if we attempted to deliver care based on the income that we receive from the state and the feds, we wouldn't be getting it done. So we've always raised money, treating roughly 500 to 600 people annually, and we're able to raise roughly 1.3 million, but we need to do more. We need to grow.
When people give to the Center for Great Expectations, they are giving to a lost and found, except the things that people are finding aren't belongings. They're their lives, their hopes, their dreams, their souls. They can find all of that back here. And without people's generosity, it's just about impossible to do that.
I drew this painting, and it says spread your wings, and it's a butterfly. I related to my recovery on this image, a caterpillar. They then turns into a cocoon, and then it's finally ready to fly and spread its wings. That's how it is with my recovery.
Feeling that they matter, and that's what we're trying to confront and address. That's what CG is really about, is saying to everybody who comes through our doors, staff, residents, volunteers, I don't care who you are, you have significant value in the world. And the best thing that we can do for one another is try to put a light on that and let it explode in a wonderful way.
Now there's this thought that when life goes out, new life can come in. And you are on this new embarking of your life. And I just put here that I think that you have this opportunity, this responsibility to live, Maris. You do.
This place is such a beautiful, this is the best gift I have been given in my life, besides my daughter. But like seriously, I would not be where I'm at today. And I mean that, I'm in a beautiful place today.